Welcome to the Gritty Podcast. I am your host, Brian Call, and I am joined by my brother, the Gritty Broman, Brent Call. How are you?
I'm well. Thank you.
Today's podcast is with Rihana Cary, and she works in the offices here at Mountain Ops down the hall from where I'm generally here when I'm not in the mountains somewhere and when she's not in the mountains somewhere. And Rihana Cary is, I started interviewing her like 4 or 5 years ago when I first started the podcast. She lived in the same neck of the woods I lived in. And we got to meet each other, and she's a bow hunter, just a legit outdoor bow hunter gal. And she has stacked up, on this podcast, we go over her recent elk hunt that she did on public land over the counter. She goes out and by herself, essentially. Not that Jeff didn't help, but
he held the camera.
He mostly was a pack mule. So her boyfriend, Jeff, went with her. And they went out into the wilderness in Oregon, over-the-counter tag.
Being a pack mule is a time-honored tradition. I mean, if you haven't spent time as a pack mule, can you consider yourself a real adult?
Brent knows, because that's all he's done. So Rihana is a, this is her sixth elk with a bow. She's killed some great ones. She's killed a couple solo.
Her first one was solo.
Some blacktail deer and some other things. And I've kind of watched her through the years, and she's not she doesn't like brag about these things. She just does them. Rihanna's the sort of person that breaks stereotypes. You know, she's your woman in the hunting industry. She's attractive. And, you know, these stereotypes are that they don't know how to hunt or they're doing it for the wrong reasons. And Rihana is one of those people, one of those types that breaks that stereotype because she does love to hunt genuinely. Otherwise, she wouldn't grind it out solo on an elk hunt, especially on an over-the-counter hunt where you don't see stuff for days and it's a grind, and then she finds a way to make it happen. And she's competent. She's very legit. She's put in the time and the effort. And she and Cameron Haynes have been friends for a long time, and she talks a little bit about Cam's influence and in helping her develop some mental toughness because Cam's a freak.
Yo, Cam's is a heartless savage. There's no room in his heart for mercy.
Well, when it comes to, you know, trying to, you know, exercising mental toughness, yeah. I mentioned that on a recent podcast, listening to him and Joe Rogan talk about Truett, his son Truett, like running that 100-mile race.
I'm proud of my son for running 91, but you know what, Brian?
It's not 100.
It's not 100.
It's savage. So, anyway. It really does make me think about mental toughness a lot. And we talk about this on today's podcast with Rihana because she's a gal. So, you know, she's not as strong as, you know, a big male dude is. And here she is. She's got to carry her load out and her meat, and it's miles and miles.
She's done
and
it solo.
It's in a deep canyon. Well, this time she had Jeff helping her. But still, man, it's like Caitlin did the same thing, and she carried some heavy loads out on our youth hunt that we did recently, our elk hunt. You know, it takes some mental, more mental toughness than physical toughness. Now, Rihanna's fit, and she takes good care of herself, and she's a strong gal, but still, there's a big mental component there, and she talks about that too. It's a great story from a really neat human being, a great human being. I think you're going to enjoy this podcast, so before we jump in, little business, sign up for the newsletter. Please go to briancall.com, sign up for the newsletter, and then we can notify you when we get a new video out, get some new film out. We got some great new hunts coming out here soon. So it'd be nice to send you an email and say, hey,
guess what?
Free new video,
stuff, bro.
And we're giving away stuff. So more giveaways for people who are signed up for the newsletter. Use the code GRITTY at sissysticks.com. And you can get 15% off a pair of trekking poles that I think are freaking awesome. Great deal. I think the competitor poles are right around twice as much money.
Almost. For like they're this around at, $200.
At like REI, you can get these for $110. They've got carbon fiber uppers, aluminum lowers, and I beat the crap out of them, and they are awesome. And I think they're one of those underrated pieces of gear that everybody should look into. Use the code GRITTY at Mountain Ops and get free shipping. And that's good for right now. Use Gritty. It's Optober. Go out there and check out what's going on at Mountain Ops and save some money on some supplements. And that's it. Let's jump into the show. Welcome to the Gritty Podcast. I am your host, Brian Call. And today I am joined by Rihana Cary, who we have been friends for probably 4.5 years.
Yeah, I would say so. Maybe even longer. No, because I've been with Mountain Ops for 5 years or so.
Yeah, yeah, probably 5 years. Yeah. And you're just one of those people I really admire that I think is really underappreciated. So we're going to talk about your story. You know, there's a lot of people who have been on elk hunts that know how hard it is, archery elk hunts, even blacktail. And you're one of those gals that gets it done on public land, on over-the-counter hunts, with a bow. You even did a solo elk hunt. And it's not like you're shooting baby bulls. This season, you had an incredible season. You had an incredible elk hunt, and I want to get the story behind it. I actually watched the film, and that's what we're going to cover today. We're going to talk about Rihana's September elk hunt.
And your elk hunt, because you had an awesome hunt, too.
I did. I can shed a little light on mine, too. But just to set the stage, okay, it was you and Jeff.
Yes.
And who is Jeff exactly?
Jeff is my boyfriend. He got to follow me around in the woods for most of September, and we're still together, so that's good. Actually, we had so much fun together. So, yeah, he's my boyfriend, and he was excited to go on his first archery elk hunt because he's never done that before. He shot elk with a rifle and deer with a rifle, and he's a big waterfowl hunter, but he's never gotten into archery. It's always something that he's wanted to do, but you know, once he met me, he was like, wow, this is really cool. I would love to get into, you know, the sport. And
do you have, we don't have Jeff here right now, because I would love to get his, like, what's Rihana like out there? Is she like, stop moving, or is she really laid back?
It just depends. And I think too, like, at first, it's like every little twig, like turn around. Like, but he's also a large human, so he's
a big dude,
6'7". You know, he's got big feet, so it's like, okay, Rihana, you need to give him a break. Like, you know, we're still getting close to elk, and two, like, you know, we all are conscious of other people's noise, but we all make noise ourselves too. I'm like, oh, that sticker. You know, you step on a log and it's loud.
Absolutely.
So it's like just honing it in and being like, make this a great experience, because I don't want him to quit on me. You know what I mean?
Totally.
And I think too, it's like, I'm very conscious of like the way that I talk to him, because it's like, you know, in a partnership or whatnot, you just have to like give them like, thank you, you're doing so good. And sometimes he's like, could you stop telling me I'm doing such a good job?
You know, please? What though? Like, I did that with my daughter on that little hunt we did recently.
Yeah.
We're hiking the mountain and I was so proud of her. I'm like, you're doing great. You're doing, and it's a tough hill to climb. Mm-hmm. After a while, she's like, yes, I'm doing great, but you don't have to tell me. And what did you think I was going to do? Well, I don't know. And she's like, it makes me feel like you thought I was an idiot or something.
That's how Jeff felt. And I could tell. I'm like, okay, Rihana, stop telling him what a good job he's doing. But I'm like,
it's a little condescending, but at the same time, if it's genuine, you don't mean it that way.
No, I appreciate him, and I appreciate him going on, you know, those long hikes with me. And he was so good, because I feel like a lot of times, and this is what I told him from the beginning, I was like, listen, I'm kind of intense to hunt with. Like, I want to do things my way. I listen to my instincts and I follow my heart, honestly. Like, I just, that's how I hunt. I'm like, okay, thinking about things, and I overanalyze things, and then I make a decision based on that. And I don't really like to have anyone's 2 cents about it, which kind of is, you know,
right.
Sometimes I do, like, sometimes I'll ask for help and be like, what do you think? Cause I'm torn, you know?
Yeah.
But if I'm, you know, doing something, there's a reason behind it, and I don't want to be questioned or like said, oh, you should do it this way or you should do it that way.
It's interesting you say that, cause this year I did solo elk hunt. And one of the reasons I really wanted to go hunt solo was because I like people. Mm-hmm. And I try to be really considerate of other people's ideas and thoughts. And I don't like to act like I know everything. Mm-hmm. And when I'm out there hunting, so I'll go, well, what do you think? And this person, maybe they're a dominant personality, will say, well, I would do this. And I'm thinking, I wouldn't do that. But then it starts to change how I want to hunt or how I would hunt, because I want to take into account these other people I'm dragging around with me who are part of this thing.
Yep.
Where if I go solo, no one tells me what to do. Yep. I just do it my way 100% of the time. I don't have anybody there like influencing my input. I talked to Ryan Lampers last year when we did our coos deer hunt in Arizona, and he said, Brian, I just think when you hunt alone, because he did this stalk, and David Brinker and I are sitting there watching the stalk from a distance. And the whole evening we watched him do his thing.
Yeah.
And he said that he hasn't done that very often where he hunts with other people.
Yep.
And he came back and he's like, I just felt pressure that I needed to move and I needed to do things and I needed to do, because you're watching.
Yes.
And because I'm worried about you guys wasting your night there, you know, and so maybe if I hurry this up, you can go hunt somewhere else. And and he's like, all these things got into my head that when I'm alone, never happens. And so I was really, I don't know, it really struck me. And I thought, you know, I really need to do this more by myself. And you've killed an elk by yourself and you've hunted alone. I decided, you know, I'm going to go do this solo.
Yeah.
And it was incredible because I just relied on my own instincts, which I want to do. And it's given me I'd say in the last 2 or 3 years, especially the last 2 years, I'm much more like you where I don't really care what the other person thinks anymore.
Yep.
Like I got to do it my way.
Yep.
And it's served me really well over the last year and a half or so to just go with my instincts and not be clouded by anyone else that's out there. And at the end of the day, ultimately it's your hunt, it's your tag, it's your experience. And I want to share it with others, but at the same time, you know, I am not Corey Jacobson. I'm not Rihana Cary. I'm not someone else.
You're Brian Cole.
And I got to rely on my talents, my skills, my instincts to really, I think, be successful. And it's hard to do when you're with a team or a group.
Yeah. And I've done it both ways. I mean, I do love hunting with other people. And I feel like I hunt with a lot of women. And women are a little bit different when they're hunting together. It's like, you know, they're not giving their two cents. They're kind of just, you know, along for the ride. It's not like, oh, well, I think you should do this. But they also have great input. Because at some point, I'm like so torn. I'm like, what do you think? And I'll really listen. But I'll only ask for advice if I really need it, you know? And and also, for me, I feel like I've had a lot of situations where I've been put in not the most ideal situation, and it was based on somebody else's opinion, right? And so then I get mad, and I'm like, oh my gosh, well, I should have just listened to what I wanted to do, because I wanted to do the opposite. And if I had, then I'm sure that this would have happened. There would have been better results, right?
Yeah.
And so
you own it either way. You own it either way. If you made the decision and you stuck by your decision, it's like, okay, this didn't work out. That's my fault.
Yes.
But what's worse is when you don't go by your instincts and you listen to someone else and you go out and it doesn't work out, and you knew it wasn't going to when you started it, but you gave into the pressure.
Yes.
And after hunting with other people that are way different than me, it's like, well, yeah, it could have worked for them. Yeah. Given their, maybe they can shoot lights out with a bow. Mm-hmm. So that would have worked for them. The approach they suggested I do was ideal for them, not for me.
Yep.
I need to go with me.
Yep, exactly. And that's how I feel, because there's been, like I said, multiple situations, and it makes me more salty about it. You know, I'm like, oh, I really wish that I would have done what I wanted to do, because then I wouldn't be in the situation. Or if I was, then it would have been my fault. And because I don't like placing that blame on somebody else, you know, if you get lost or you're going the wrong way. That's really where it happened, is when I was hunting in New Zealand. It was like, I knew where to go. And I said, no, this is not the right way. And listening to somebody else, oh no, we're going the right way. No, we're not. Like, I know where I walked, and this is not the same path, you know? Mm-hmm. And so then we ended up spending an extra 2-3 hours on the mountain because I didn't listen to my instincts and say, no, this is not right. I'm going to go this way. You can go off the, you know, in this direction.
Right.
So it's really like, you know, listening to yourself. And that's why I like hunting alone. Or like with Jeff, he did such a good job of like just letting me do my thing. You know, he just kind of sat back and watched, and it was awesome, because not a lot of guys do that. You know, they want to, they want to, you mentor, know, have input. Or teach, oh, yeah, or teach. Yeah. And it was cool because I was able to kind of teach him things, you know, because getting close to an animal is hard. And I try to do it in a way, I think it's always hard learning from a spouse or a partner, because it's like, you have to go about it and like, and be very delicate about the situation, not like telling you what to do. Because if he tells me what to do, I'm like, I don't need to be told what to do. Okay. Like right. I'm an independent woman. Like don't even cross that boundary with me, you know, and he's right. very independent too. So, but it just, it, we worked so well together. And like, I don't know if we were hunting together, you know, if he was hunting, it might be different. Like mm-hmm. I might've been a little bit more like on it, like, oh, do this, do that, you know? And I don't know that he would want that. I don't know. We'll see, but he will go elk hunting with me next year for sure. Cause he's just hooked. And especially after the experience that we had, he was like, oh my gosh. Like he was so excited.
And so this is a public land over the counter mm-hmm. hunt that you did. Yeah. It's in Oregon, kind of your stomping grounds and places you've spent some time.
Yeah.
And this bull is giant. Like he seems huge. Like I've never shot a bull this big. What does he score?
Well, I took it to the taxidermist uh-huh. and he said like 350. He that's a guess. Yeah. And I asked him to score it actually.
It looks like some kind of, it's just ridiculous.
I don't know. I honestly, like, it was so crazy. I mean, this area that I've hunted in Oregon, I've hunted for the past 4 or 5 years with my good friend, Corey Stanforth. He's actually the one who brought me to the area.
Yeah.
And,
Corey's a stud. You can find him on Instagram. Oh my gosh. He is so fun. He is a fun dude.
I love him. He's one of my best friends, and his wife, Kylie, too. Like, they're mm-hmm. just salt of the earth people. And, you know, I lived with them for a long time, and we've just all been such good friends. And so he actually killed a bull the very first day. Jeff and I were going to meet him. And he calls me or texts me the morning, like, we're on our way to where he's at.
Yeah.
Just shot a bull. I'm like, you jerk. This is like the fifth time he's done that, where I'm on my way to where he's at and he shoots a bull. And I'm like, seriously, the first 3 hours of your hunt and you shoot a bull. Okay. Well, cool. We'll be there to help you track it, you know? So that was cool. So Jeff and him got to meet and like, you know, developed that brohood because it's like, we got to pack out an elk together. You know, that kind of relationship that it develops, just being able to
shared
do hard
suffering.
Things together. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But it was also suffering because by the time we got there, you know, Corey wasn't sure. He was tracking blood for a long ways. The bull had gone uphill for a long time, came down a hill. And you know how sometimes when you're trailing blood, you get frustrated and you're kind of like, okay, well, I think he went this way. Well, he went a completely different way than Corey thought. And so Jeff and I were able to kind of help him track and find the blood trail. It's, you know, team effort. It's fun to do it solo, but at the same time, when other people come in, it helps. So anyways, we trailed. And it was so cool finding his bull because Corey was at this point where we didn't think he was going to find it. He was sure that we weren't going to find it. You know, he was kind of talking like that. And I'm like, let's just keep on going. You've got really good blood. And we ended up finding it. So it was a really, really cool experience and cool thing to experience together, you know, and I loved for him and Jeff to be able to get to know each other because Corey's one of my favorite people. And I'm like, what do you think? You have to make sure, you know, I have to make sure that you guys like each other. And they're like bros now. So it's awesome. But yeah, so that happened. And I was like, oh, well, you're welcome for helping you come pack out your elk. Like now when I get one, are you going to come help me? You know, no, you have a job and a family. And so anyways, he hunted with us for a day or so, and then he ended up going back to home, you know, because he has a wife and kids. But yeah, so Jeff and I stayed in this area for about a week, a little bit less. And, you know, we were into bulls every single day, but it was just not that time. It wasn't the rut. So you're just hoping and a prayer in that you're going to walk up on something. And this area is like, it's really tough. And that's why I think we love it so much because it's like
physically
these deep ravines. Yeah, you have to go.
Yeah, you're going where people won't go.
Yes.
And to kill a bull like that, you have, especially over the counter public land, if you're going to kill a bull like that, that bull is hanging out where people don't go.
Yeah.
Or he wouldn't live to be 350 inches.
Exactly.
You know?
And two, it's thick. It's a lot of jack pine. It's hard to get to. Like these areas that they hang out in are so protected by jack pine. You try walking through that and you're like, oh my gosh. Kill me now. Like, I'm just leave me here to die because I don't want to even keep on going through this. So it was cool. Yeah. Jeff was like, I can't believe you freaking do this for an animal. Like he's, you know, in the military. So he definitely like knows suffering and it was nowhere near what he's gone through within his training. But, you know, he's like, this is still really hard.
It's intense. Yeah.
And it's good.
And it is. It's it's just a, sort of an all day constant grind elk hunting. You're in tough country,
and, miles. You're walking uphill, going down these crazy.
And you're
things,
chasing bugles falling. When they finally are talking, and they might you might be here and they're two ravines away, and you're like, man, where do you got to go?
Yeah,
that's where they are.
Yep. So we did that for about a week, and we just didn't have luck, and so. I was close a few times, but it just didn't come through. So, cause it was still early season. It was the first week of September. So, you know, we came back to Utah. Then I was told that I had to drive the truck to California. Mm-hmm. So I was like, my mind was turning. I'm like, well, if I'm going to California, I'm going back to Oregon. Like, I am going back to Oregon. So I worked it out so that we flew back to Salt Lake. We drove the general truck to the winter.
Truck. Yeah, the guy who won the truck.
Yeah, which was so cool. That was so fun. Oh, yeah, so fun. And so I told Jeff, I was like, do you want to come with me? He's on leave right now. So he was like, yeah, I'm going to go with you for sure. So he came with me to deliver the truck. And then I was like, and then... We're going to rent a car and we're going to drive back to Oregon. I actually left my car in Oregon because I found out while I was in Oregon that I had to go back to California, which is this huge long thing, whatever. But so left my car there, drove my car to Eastern Oregon, and then had just like 2 or 3 days to keep on hunting this area. Well, we get to the area, we're camping, we're on a ridgetop. And the bulls are going insane all night long. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, this is so awesome. And it was in a different spot than I normally camp because somebody was camped in our other area. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it was kind of a new area for me. But yeah, so heard bugles all night long.
How far in did you have to hike?
Not far.
Okay.
To camp. No.
It's just steep.
Yeah. Steep and thick. And I mean, like I said, I usually go in farther and I had planned to, but just because it was our first night, it was like, you know, we're just going to camp here. We'll see how it is. Well, bugles all night long. So I'm like, okay, well, this is good. This is good area. This is where I'm going to stay here. I was planning on going somewhere else in the morning and just driving to where we needed to go and then hiking in the 3 miles or whatnot. Mm-hmm. But so because of those bugles, we stayed. In the morning we woke up and they're still just bugling, going crazy. And you know, I knew that they work their way up in the evenings, stay on these tops in the night and then head down into these ravines where the water is in the mornings. That's what they do in this area. So I knew that they were heading down and we just followed them and we chased bugles all morning. There was 4 to 5 bulls that were just kind of going crazy. And you know, it's so hard cause it's so thick. It's like, okay, well this bull's right here. Well, now there's another one over here. Then there's another one over here. Well, was this the one that was just right here? Like, what's going on? Because there's so many bulls that are just bugling. And so you're just kind of chasing the bugles and having to move super slow because it's so thick that you're going to walk right on top of them. Mm-hmm. Like, you can't see in front of you very much. So you just have to go slow, keep listening, and keep on, you know, watching and trying to figure out what's going on just by the sounds, which was cool because we heard some, we heard two come together and start fighting. And it was kind of at the bottom of the ravine.
So you're just taking, like, you're standing still a lot.
Standing still a lot and trying to find a path to go on that's not super loud because that's a part of it. It's in between all of these jack pines. So you kind of have to just work your way through. And it is loud because there's small trees you have to fit in between. And so your backpack, it's just very...
You're kind of like just still hunting though is what you're doing. You're trying to get yourself in there without being caught and taking your time.
Exactly. And that's how I've had a majority of my success is still hunting, just being going very slow. And that's, you know, what I told Jeff in the beginning. I was like, this is what I do. Like, I just kind of walk a little bit, listen, walk a little bit, listen. And I'm very quiet. I'm patient. I take my time. And when you're by yourself, that's totally reasonable. You can do whatever you want. You could sit there for 10, 15, 20 minutes.
Dude, that's what Lampers does. I'm watching him. I'm like, I do it too.
Yep.
But when you have people with you, it's like, let's run in and let's bugle this guy and let's get him to charge in.
You get more aggressive when you're with somebody else. Like,
and it's funny, this year, I got far more opportunities just never calling.
Yeah.
Just moving in.
Yep. And two, when they're going crazy like that, you let them call. You don't need to add another bull to the mix. I mean, they are fired up. But for me in this situation, I'm the only caller. So I'm going to call a bull in straight on to me. Like,
it's tough.
It's really hard. If I could have Jeff hang back and call
a couple hundred yards.
Because they are so fired up. But at this point, most of these bulls all have cows. So getting them to leave them, it's tough.
What are you doing about the wind this whole time?
Oh, checking it. It's good. Our wind is good.
Pretty solid.
Oh yeah, it's solid.
The weather looked like it was a little cooler, and so
it wasn't raining. It rained the night before, and I think that's really what helped kind of fire them up. And it was cooler. So yeah, the wind was super stable. And two in the mornings, it always is. It's coming up, and so at about 10 o'clock, it switches though. So you have to like get down there and get in there before that time.
Yeah.
So yeah, we just kind of kept on going. Finally got to the bottom of the ravine, and it's like it's a steep.
Deep.
Bottom. Mm-hmm. Steep, deep bottom. So that's why they're so protected in there. And that's why no one
goes
there.
That's why they like to go there too, because all the wind's blowing downhill all night long. Yep. So they're down there where they can smell anything coming their way.
Yeah. It's a great area. That's why they get so big. But so, you know, we just kept on going. And at one point they kind of were quiet. And I'm just like, we had bumped a herd, and I'm like, oh my gosh, great, well that sucks. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, you're just kind of feeling defeated at that point, and they were starting to quiet down, and so I just was like, let's just sit down and have a snack. And so we were in the bottom of the where the water is, and we're just sitting there kind of eating, and all of a sudden, like 100 yards up on this other side of the hill, a bull starts bugling, and I was like, that bull is right there. Leave your backpack. We're going to walk over there. And I could hear him like crunching up. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, okay, you stay right here. I'm going to go and start walking my way up this trail in hopes to see where he's at so I can kind of slip in on him. Right. And so
Now I watched this because you actually have it on video.
Yeah.
Was Jeff, did it just on his phone?
No. We have a little 4K, Sony handy cam, which has awesome zoom, and it's 4K.
And was he filming a lot of this hunt?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. We have a whole story kind of built up to it, right?
Cool.
So it's really, it's pretty cool.
He's not half bad behind the camera.
No, he really, I told him, you're going to be hired.
Yeah.
I know. So I just started walking up this trail. Uh-huh. And as I'm walking up, I hear something coming. And so I'm like looking for it. It's a cow and a calf. And I'm like, oh, shoot. So I like hunker down, and I'm on this trail, hunker down, and just hoping, you know, that they don't see me or wind me, or because at this point I hadn't even checked the wind. I was just like, oh my gosh, he's right there. So it was good. Obviously they are literally coming straight at me on the path that I'm sitting on. So I'm just like, shoot. And they're kind of looking at me, and they're just like, oh, we don't want to go that way, there's a roadblock. So they just kind of walk broadside.
Yeah, 10 it's yards interesting to me. Like during the rut, I saw this multiple times. I see it all the time where they see you, they see something, mm-hmm. and but they don't fixate on it too much. They're like, I was going to walk that trail, but now there's something there.
Yeah.
And you know what? I'm not going to walk over there, but I'm not freaked. Yeah. I'm just going to stay 50 yards away.
Yeah. And which, because they've got so much going on. They're being chased by bulls. Like, it's like, oh, whatever. Like,
their mind's not it.
No.
Like, you try to do
they're
that.
They're high stress.
Yeah. At a different time of year when they're not rutting.
Yeah.
And it's like, I see you. And it's like alarm bark and everybody leaves.
Yeah.
But yeah, this time of year, it's different.
Yeah. Because they were fired up. That was, some of those cows were definitely in heat. You could tell because the bulls were just going insane. So I hear him bugle, and then in the distance, there was another bull kind of bugling on that same ridge, but just a little farther down.
Yep.
And so I don't really know what had happened. I have a few ideas, but the cows come by me, and then the cows are walking right by me, and I see him, and I can hear this big thing in the brush. I can tell it's a bull because it's hitting its antlers on trees. And I'm like, okay, this is something big coming in. This is definitely the bull. Get ready, Rihana. So the cows walk by me, and out of the corner of my eye, I start to see movement coming in. And so the cows go by me, and he's coming in from the far right. The cows are walking left, and they go by me. And I'm like, could this be any more perfect? I'm like, he's going to come and follow his cows on a string and come right where they're at, same track.
That's what I did this year too. I saw where the cows walked, ranged their spot, and I knew the bull was just going to follow in their exact footsteps.
Yeah. I didn't even need to range because they were 10 yards to me. So I'm like, you just freaking send it. So, which helps because that movement, would have definitely been hard if they were 20 or whatnot. So I'm like, oh, here he freaking comes. And in the video, you can see him. He's running at his cows. He's getting mad. He bugled. He was mad because I think that either they were kind of peeling off in a direction he didn't want to go. Mm-hmm. Either that was what happened, or or because they were kind of heading back towards where the bull, the other bull was bugling. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know if he had the herd with him, or maybe he was stealing these cows from another herd, that other right. herd bull. Because he was pushing them, and you could tell he was like, I don't want you to go this way. So he loops around, follows them exactly where they were at, comes literally running into me, and stops 10 yards.
That's the cool thing. Is you're at full draw.
Oh,
so
yeah.
When did you draw, and why?
Oh, because I could see him coming, and I knew that he was going to come right where his cow were, and he just started running straight at me. So that's when I came to full draw. I was like, you know, he was probably
good. Was he behind a tree when you came to full draw, or was he in the wide open? He could have seen you if he just paid attention.
No, there was a few like breaks in the terrain, and so like a few trees or whatnot that he wouldn't see me draw. So, and plus two, he was so preoccupied. He had his head down, literally had his head down, and was like pushing towards his cows. So there was a spot where I knew that he couldn't see. So that's when I came to full draw, and I came to full draw pretty early because I knew that he was going to come running by me.
Because on the video, you're at full draw, like, you're just there.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. I would rather be at full
draw. He's up on the hill.
Yeah, he's up on the hill coming down, and he was coming fast, so I just knew. I was like, come to full draw, he's going to run right in front of me.
Well, what's crazy is he is cruising down the hill like that,
yeah.
And then
stops.
And he stops. Like, he couldn't have stopped more perfect.
Broadside.
You didn't have to cow call.
Nothing. I was getting ready to, and I actually didn't have a mouth reading because I was sitting there eating a snack. And it all just happened so fast. So I was like, okay, I'm going to have to meow, you know, like do the meow, right?
Yeah, right.
And stop him. So I'm like getting ready to do this. Well, he just stopped on his own. And lets out this crazy bugle that I'd been chasing all morning long. And I was like, bye, Felicia. Like, I just decided, I was like, you know what? I'm not even going to let you finish that bugle. And I just let her eat. Like, I just was like, I mean, it couldn't have been more perfect. I'm like, you're broadside standing there bugling with your mouth open. Like, oh my gosh, what the heck is it? I don't even know what's going through my head at this point. It was just happened so fast. It's just like, I didn't even see his antlers. Honestly, when I saw his body coming, that's all I stare at. I don't look at his rack.
Yeah.
I could tell the frame, you know, it's hard to miss that. But I honestly, I didn't even look at his antlers the whole time. And that's the part I feel like, you know, why I can just keep calm, because so many people are like, oh, what kind of bull is this? Or, you know, they're preoccupied with other things. Yeah, distracted. Well, I just see those that leg, and I just look at that leg, and I just wait till it's in a good spot, until it's forward, until I can take that shot. And so, yeah, then he runs by me.
Well, it's crazy on the video. He's like, he doesn't get very far before you just take the wind out of him.
I know.
And then when he runs, the shot is money. It's money. Did you see when he ride off with your own eyes?
Like, I saw the penetration. I saw the arrow. I saw where it had hit, and, you know, I could see the blood pumping out of him, and he actually ran right by me in between two trees and hit my arrow on a tree, and so I saw it break off. So I knew that was good. You know, I had great penetration right behind the front shoulder. So I knew it was a good shot, but still, I just started using expandables. They just passed expandables as legal in Oregon this year. So I was having some problems with my broadheads tuning, and I just didn't have time to take it in to kind of get it fixed at the shop. So I was like, I'm just going to use these expandables for now.
And which ones were you using?
The Severs from, I think it's an Easton company.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Easton Sever.
Yeah. And that's what a bunch of the guys here are using. They've shot a bunch of animals with them and tried and tested and true,
you know, it's kind of a pivoting, you know, I've taken a look at a lot of guys in the office are using them right now.
Yeah. And that's what they were saying, that it pivots well if you hit a bone or, you know, graze something like that.
It's interesting.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They worked for me. So,
well, especially when you're having trouble getting broadheads to tune
and
we're all very busy, not just, you know, in this office, but people that have, you know, business jobs, whatever, whatever it is, life.
Yep.
And it's hard sometimes to get all your gear dialed. And so I've been in a situation, you can screw on a mechanical. It's one thing I'll give it is you screw that mechanical head on and it's going to fly straight, even if you don't have things dialed.
Yeah. And I've always been told, like, if you're going to use an expandable, use it on a smaller animal, like deer, fine, whatever. But elk, you know, there's a lot more room for air. So I think that's kind of what got in my head after I'd made the shot.
But it's a pretty heavy-duty mechanical head, though.
Oh, yeah. No, they're heavy and they're long and, you know, they do damage, obviously, from my bull, too. You can see there was just a large gash and so much blood. I had a great blood trail, which was awesome. With my fixed broadheads, I've had issues with trailing blood, and you know, my bull I shot last year, I wouldn't have found if he wasn't in the open sage and I'd seen him go down. I mean, I would have obviously found him because it was only like 100 and 150 yards that he ran. Know.
Like mine went 100 about, you can't, there's not much blood. There wasn't as much blood as I wanted. I mean, I punched through bone and the arrow went all the way through the body cavity and out the other side, shoulder bone. So I like that aspect of it. Don't know if I could do that with, make that same shot with a mechanical.
Yeah.
At the same time, doesn't, the trade-off is I've had way bigger blood trails when I've used a mechanical.
Yep.
You know, I used a mechanical in Colorado a couple of years ago on an elk. Mm-hmm. That thing went through quartering away. It went through the back, you know, diaphragm, liver area, all the way through the vitals and stopped inside the shoulder on the offside. And that's a mechanical head.
Yeah. Mine stuck in the other side. It didn't have a complete pass through because it did hit a, must've hit a rib on the other side. I didn't like get in there too much and look, I should have. But yeah, so my first thought after I shot him, I knew it was a good shot, but I was just like, shocked, and I was just thinking, I you see on camera, I just sit there literally for a minute and I'm got my mouth wide open and I'm just listening because I heard him go down too. Yeah. And I heard the gurgling.
That's
and
what I heard too.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Until
you see that animal down, I'm like, babe, that was a really good shot. Or right. Yeah. Jeff walks up to me and I go, was that a good shot? He's like, yes, you saw it. That was a good shot. Like, good shot. I'm like, yeah, I know it was a good shot. But... And then I look at my arrows and I'm like, okay, I'm making sure I use the right one. Like, okay, like I you can see all of these things and I know what I'm thinking as it's going through my head, like double thinking everything, like, okay, checking everything. Like, okay,
right.
Okay. I'm like, okay, let's just let it sit for a minute. I was like, I'm pretty sure I heard him go down. And he's like, me too. And I was just like, okay. And still, like, I always just am like never celebrating. I wasn't too excited until you see that animal. It's like, oh, this huge relief. So yeah, he didn't go far at all. He just made it kind of across the creek and up the hill just a little bit, not even far. He was maybe 70 yards from where I shot him because it was a good double lung shot. But yeah, I honestly, I just, when I first saw the animal, I was like, I literally was like, are you kidding me? I was like, how did this just happen? Like, it's just surreal. Like, it was so surreal. I didn't even believe it. And still, even once I packed the bull out, and even now, it's like, that accomplishment is still hard to swallow, which is weird because it's like, I don't know what I did. And I feel really lucky that it happened. You know, like, I don't know. I just feel like I attribute a lot of the things that have happened as luck. You know, it's like, I try, but it's also like, you know, things happen. I'm like, wow, how did that work out for me?
Well, I will say this. A lot of people, a lot of guys, gals put in the effort and the work and the time. Mm-hmm. And they get themselves into the same situation that you were in. I know I've been there a lot.
Yeah.
Where everything just comes together perfectly.
Yeah.
But capitalizing on the shot, that is something that a lot of people don't do. Mm-hmm. In that moment, or just the opportunity, I should say.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not the shot. Maybe it's when they decide to come to full draw. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's, you know, something that they do, a movement, a sound they make, where they don't capitalize on the opportunity. Mm-hmm. You've been able to have those crazy, perfect storm moments, mm-hmm. but then also capitalize.
Yeah.
And that's pretty special. At the same time, I think time in the woods, it makes this sort of thing happen. Mm-hmm. You know, the more time that you get to spend in September out there, putting yourself in positions where something like that can happen, the more likely it's going to happen. Some point, I just tell myself, at some point, something's going to come together.
Yep.
Things are going to be perfect.
Yep.
It might take 3 hours of the first day, like with Corey, and it might take like 17 days.
Yep.
And I think that is... it's just sticking with it until you can do it. Not everybody can because they have vacation. You had obligations. It just, the perfect storm came and you took advantage of it.
Well, when I took the job with Mountain Ops, I told Jordan, I was like, one thing for me is September is my month. Like, I want to be able to hunt the whole time of September, right?
Right.
And that was part of the, my job that he had, you know, offered is like, you know, you're going to do a lot of hunting, which I'm like, okay, this is what I want to do. So like, you know, that's totally fine. And, you know, they're so wonderful. And like in the moment of like recovering the bull, I just felt so thankful to Mountain Ops. And I just felt thankful that I could be there. And I'm like, this is for all my teammates that are in the office and, you know, like, in there, like, I just feel like I'm grateful to them because, you know, I can be out here doing this right now and, you know, my presence isn't missed. Right. So yeah, I brought it in here and showed everyone and was like, thank you. You know, like just really like thankful for the opportunity to be out there. Like, I get it. And that's one thing, you know, if you're people say negative things, which I saw on my post, you know, must be nice to be able to be out there in September, like for 10 days. Actually, that's what one guy said, for 10 days. And because it was 10 days that it took me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, that's a regular week off, by the way. Like, mm-hmm. do you not have vacation? Well, sounds like your job sucks. But like, so, or, you know, there's other things like people have a family, they take vacation to go with their family, you know,
everybody
like
everybody has priorities.
Yeah, exactly. And mm-hmm. my priority is September. Like, I don't have kids yet. I'm not married. It's like, I don't have anything but this right now. And like, that's where my heart is. And it's, so it's like, this is what
it's unfortunate that when people see something like that, and it's usually as a result of they weren't able to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
and I'm a woman
rather than,
so that's what makes it worse.
Rather than feel like happy for you, mm-hmm. the initial reaction is jealousy.
Yeah.
And then the reaction to that is they got to tear you down. Or, you know, the best thing that they like to do is, well, let's minimize her accomplishment in every way possible. That way we can feel better about our own failures.
Yeah.
Rather than just saying, maybe I did something wrong. Maybe I can learn from this person. Maybe there's, you know, how cool is this that this person, like, rather than celebrating what you were able to do, they take that negative tack. And it's just, we have too much of that going on already. And
you know what? Like, honestly, for me, it fuels me. Like, you want to say that? Guess what? That's going to make me try even harder. Like, I don't care, you know, what you have to say, but like, I'm going to prove you wrong. Like, that is not who I am. And if that's what you think, then that's fine.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm a woman, whatever. I mean, and sometimes I can't pack as much weight or whatever, you know, but at the same time, it's like, I don't care because I'm doing what I love to do. Like, I'm not doing it for him. I'm doing it for myself. Cause like, once you accomplish that, like I was telling someone the other day, I was just like, I've never felt like such an independent, strong woman before because I know I can do anything and I don't need anyone's help to do it. You know? Yeah. I mean, it's nice to have help, obviously, like, cause I was hunting in the same area last year alone by myself for like a week, you know? And if I had shot a bull, which I had multiple opportunities and didn't capitalize, like that was a problem.
Yep.
And it was my gear that failed. No, I'm just kidding. Really though. So, you know, for me, like if I had done that by myself, I probably would have been dead in that canyon, you know, trying to pack all that meat out alone. Like who knows, maybe it would have spoiled or whatnot. And so, being able to go back and like also realize like you do need help sometimes. Like Jeff mm-hmm. was there and was able to help me pack it out. Like, and it was the hardest pack I've ever done
it's
in my
nice
life.
Nice to have a 6'7" dude there to like help you like do stuff.
I know.
It's nice to have a beast around. Like,
I
just, like,
know. Yeah. His pack was so heavy. It was at least like 160. I don't know. It was a lot heavier than mine was.
Yeah.
And honestly, so we filled my pack up with the cape and the head, mm-hmm. which I didn't realize how heavy that really is. Because like that's 100 pounds.
Bull that big?
I know.
Yeah.
And you saw how it was hanging down on the ground. Like I literally, it was in tears the whole time just because it was so hard. I literally had to be in my head every 5 seconds. You got this. You can do it. I'm like singing these songs to myself and just like, like praying, like, please God, give me the strength to take one more step. That was me the whole time because it was so hard. It was the hardest thing I've ever done. I'm like, if childbirth is worse than this, I ain't doing it. Like it was so bad, but it was, you know, it was definitely a good experience and to have Jeff there and like be so supportive because we filled my pack with the cape, the head, and then we put one of the front or all of the loose meat in it.
Yeah.
Loose meat, neck meat, you know, it was heavy AF. It was bad. And so, like, I could feel it clenching down on my hips. Yeah. And so, like, I was walking, but I was like, I can't do this.
Shuffling.
And even with the cape and the head and a little bit of meat, like, I was still shuffling. But two, it was like all these downfall. There's no trails down there. There's not one single trail. It's like logs and downfall, right, and like tons of stuff. And so uneven terrain, going over logs that are like as up to your belly, you know? So, mm-hmm. So having to do that with those awkward antlers too, it's like I was hitting every single thing and it was pulling me down, or like I was getting caught. It took me a while to figure out how to do it. But so I ended up having to stop and take a little bit of the meat out and leave it a little farther down the trail, because I was like, this
been
is
there before.
Yeah. I was like, I can't do this. And it was awesome because I feel like, you know, you could either sit there and be like, well, you're not pulling your weight, or get upset about it or whatnot. And Jeff was like, no, good job, babe. Like, it's okay. Do whatever you need to do. Like, this is hard. Like, you've got this, you can do it, you know.
It's just going to take more trips. Yeah.
Yeah. And we were able to do it in two, which is still pretty good. But yeah, it was the worst night of my life, honestly. I was at the end. I've never been so excited to be at the bottom. Like, we decided to pack it out because we went down the ravine.
I feel like that
there.
A lot when I hunt with lampers.
Why? Like, I don't want to shoot this right here. What was I thinking? Could I have shot a smaller bull, please? Like,
I mean, I've done it before with Ben and Anthony too, and other people. It's like, you shoot it where it lives. It's sort of, we did this youth hunt just a week ago, and where this bull is at, the 7x7 bull, it's just way, way off grid, like, compared to where we're at. And it's like, but that's the bull we want.
Yep.
Or we could shoot this one, but that's the one we want.
Yep.
It's like, do you settle and take the one that's right by the road or that's close to the trail, or do you just do the adventure?
Well, okay. Like, I would take either one, but if that other bull wasn't there and this one was, I'd be like, oh my, sweet. But, and that's one thing too. It's like, I'm not going to always take the hard route. I want to, but like if it's there and presents, you
it is,
take
but
what nature gives you, right?
When you have a goal, you know, it's like, it's like wherever it's at, it's where it's at.
Yeah.
We'll find a way to get it out.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's also the difference between people that are consistently successful with a bow during archery season, especially on the type of public land over the counter thing that you're doing. Mm-hmm. It's like, hey, I'm willing to do that. A lot of people would look at where you shot that bull and say, never. Mm-hmm. I'm never going to kill a bull in that spot because how would I get it out? I need horses.
Yeah.
But you don't need horses.
You are the horse.
Yeah.
Not that I want to do that every year for the rest of my life, probably. I mean, I will, but because it's like this addiction that you
get. So you've done this multiple times. Like, how many bulls have you taken with a bow?
I think six.
Six with a bow.
And this is my six.
My question is, during this journey, you know, you've learned a lot. Last year you were talking about being
there's a seven. I don't know. I think it's six.
I
don't know.
That's enough. That's enough. Rihanna, if you said two, it was enough.
Well, I have one missing now that's not my house, as you heard. So
let's say in like last year you went out and you spent a bunch of days out there alone. Mm-hmm. What would you say that you have learned in the last couple of years that has that you've really leveraged to be more successful? Or just in general, like, how are you different now than you were 4 or 5 years ago?
Oh man, I am a lot different. I feel like, as far as like my mental strength, you know, I feel like it's easy. I was telling you this yesterday. I feel like it's easy to quit before your body like allows you to. So this is like something I've learned from Cam Haynes. It's like your body is capable of anything, you know? So I just don't worry about that and work more on like mental toughness. Like, you can do this. Don't quit. Like, you've got this, like a lot of people, their self-talk is really negative, right?
Yeah.
So for me, my self-talk is always positive. I'm always encouraging myself. As crazy as it sounds, but it's like, you can do this. Like, you've got this, like, keep on going. Like, you might mess things up, but if you quit now, you're never going to know. Like, you know, it's in that last hour after the toughest climb that typically your success is going to be, right? And whether that's, Like just success of conquering the mountains or success of, in harvesting an animal. Because as long as you know that you tried as hard as you could and gave it your all, that's enough, right? For me, that's enough. But it's nicer when you have an animal to yeah. show for it. Right. But I've had many unsuccessful hunts where it's like, I can't quit because I can't quit trying because it could be that last day, the last hour that I get something, right? So I feel like it's super easy. And I've done it before where I've quit early. And that like heaviness that I feel, I'm like, gosh, I should have just stayed out there one more day. Or like I've been in trips on California where I was literally leaving. I was at the bottom of the road and I turned around and went back up because I was like, I am not going to quit. I'm going to keep on going. I still have a day and a half to hunt. I'm going to hike my happy ass back out there and I'm going to keep trying, you know? So I think it's just that, like for me, you know, not quitting has been huge. And if you would have looked at me 4 years ago, there would have been multiple instances where it's just learning over time, like that, you know, you are the only one that's holding yourself accountable. Nobody else is. And you just have to do it. Like, you know, if I let Jeff sleep in all morning, he would have, you know? Right. So it's like, I'm the one setting the alarm and making sure I get my happy butt up, you know? Yeah. Like, so it's just being able to do that. And I know it's hard for some people. And like, too, where there was a campground where we ended up camping for a few days, our first trip. And it's like, those guys are up drinking all night long, you know, till 11, 12, 1 in the morning. Do they get up? No, we were the only ones getting up in the mornings and going out, you know, and for a lot of people, that's why they go, you know, it's camaraderie. That's how it is. It's fun for them. And that's
different value system.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
different goals.
Exactly. Different goals. And so, but that same camp is where I packed my bull out of. So it was, I was like, we're going to, well, we chose to go out the easier route, the flat route, which honestly, I wish that we wouldn't have. I wish we would have gone back up that hill. But we decided to go all the way through and come out this like campground area because
kind of all downhill, but longer probably.
And they would take us back up the mountain. Right. Mm-hmm. So, because they had told us, one of the guys down there, he'd been hunting this area for years and years and he had been there before, you know, there was wolves and all sorts of stuff. So he had some really awesome insight, but it was cool because his insight was all stuff I already knew. I was like, yeah, oh yeah. Okay. Because I've been hunting here. So I know I'm like, oh yeah, that area or this area, you know, so it was really cool. But yeah, so I was able to pack that big bull out. And so everyone was in camp. They're drinking. They're like probably halfway sloshed because we didn't get it out till way late at night.
Yeah.
And so
they're probably blown away.
They were like, what the heck? It was cool though. Cause it was also like, you know, this guy has been hunting there for a long time and he's like, this is one of the biggest bulls that I've seen, you know? So it was just cool to see and like cool for them. You know, I'm like, now I bet your butts, they're going to be getting up first thing in the morning to go out and go hunt. Right. So, but like you said, it's just different, you know, you're out with your buddies having a good time. So, but for me, that's not what it is. It's like, I want to have success and I want to try and shoot an animal.
Yeah. I have multiple hunts a year and I have the ones where it's like, hey, we're rifle hunting or camping in a cabin.
Yeah.
Whitetail hunts are like this a lot for me. It's more about just hanging out at whitetail camp.
Yeah.
And then we hit the tree stand for a couple hours in the morning and then we get down, you come back. But more and more, my goal just, it's hard for me to shake until I can fill the tag I've got in my pocket. I have a really hard time doing the brotherhood thing with everybody in camp.
Yeah.
And it's evolved for me over time. And so the best thing I found for me is to try to just, because once I go to, let's say, a whitetail camp, I'm just going to hunt from morning till dark. I'm not getting out of the stand.
Yeah.
Everybody else is going out to eat. They're hanging out and they're having fun. I'm like, I can't enjoy that until I tag out.
Until you tag out.
Or go home empty. Because like you, it's like I'm just driven to make it happen. And I'm not the most talented, the most skilled, but
you're going to keep trying.
I'm going to keep trying.
Never going to quit.
I'm just not going to quit.
It was the same. So it was cool. I was lucky to get to go up to the camp with Cam and Joe and Jocko and all of those like military guys. Right. Yeah. And so it was a weird atmosphere until things started hitting the ground. Right. So it's like, they were the first ones up. You know, it was like, it was not that typical camp where it's like
they're
drinking
all
night. Yeah, they're like hyper focused on their task and they're going to make it happen. And, you know, so it was very interesting. Like, it was like, they were the first ones in bed. Like, it was cool to see, like, cause that's that mindset of like, you're going to hit the time clock at 4:30 in the morning and you're going to go all day and do what you got to do to get it done. So it was cool to see. But
and you've been friends with Cam for how long?
Gosh, I've known him for the past 8 years, probably almost. Mm-hmm. I mean, I lived in Eugene, so we met through our trainer, Eric McCormick, who I'm also super good friends with. And so I started training with Eric a long time ago, probably after my first elk hunt, because I was like, I need to get my butt in shape. So trained with Cam and Eric a bunch. And, you know, Cam has been a good friend of mine, and I'm super thankful for his friendship because I have really cool opportunities because of him. I think it's hard being Cam, you know, it's, he's got a lot of haters out there. And so it's hard, you know, how do you trust people? Well, I've always been that type of person where I'm just, you know, I'm like, I always have your back no matter what, you know, because it's just any of your, my friends that I'm, that's how I am. So it's just cool too, because it's like, it's the same way with any friends that we have in within our circle. It's like, you know, you have to have that.
Well, the sad reality is we live in this social media world. It's a bubble. And you say things about people and to people over social that you would never say to someone's face.
Yeah.
And when you actually sit down with another human being, they could disagree with you on every issue.
Yeah.
But you realize that they're actually human.
Yep.
Like face to face, and that they have a family, and that that they have struggles just like you do, and that they're actually a lot like you.
Yeah.
At the end of the day. And so nobody's perfect. And what I think is really tough in today's world with social media is a lot of things are said and done without actually the accountability of a face-to-face interaction.
Yeah. And but when you sit down, grounds to say them on, like, well, there's nothing.
Right. And when you sit down and actually talk to someone, you're like, whoa, my whole opinion of this person is completely changed. I really like this person. Yeah. And often, you know, I ran into some strangers on my elk hunt solo back at camp where I came back to the trailhead. There was a big group of guys, and I met some when we were in New Zealand. And inevitably, like, I've interviewed a lot of people through the podcast, met a lot of people. And folks ask me, what's this person like? What do you think of this person?
Yeah.
Or they'll say, that guy is a total, you know, a-hole.
Yeah.
And you're like, and I've sat there and I've been like, you know what? Actually, I kind of thought this too about XYZ person or gal. And I'm like, but then I met him and I can honestly say, this is one of the coolest people I know, or I really respect this person. All they're doing is their best, you know, they're amazing. And it across the board, there's very few people that I've met, that I've interviewed and spent some time with, that I walked away going, they're not for me. But there's a handful. There's a handful, and it's when you go to meet someone like that's your hero in a way, and you meet them, and you're like,
let down.
Oh yeah, that's not at all what I thought or hoped you would be like, and I'm really saddened by it. I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed, and. But Cam's one of those people, as I've grown to know him and become friends, he fits into that category of people that you meet that you're like, he's inspiring.
Impactful,
He's impactful. He's not what people, some people like to label him as. You know?
And he's a great friend. Like if he, you know, if you're in his inner circle or he's just a really good person, and his family is an amazing family. His wife, I know his wife super well. She's great. And, you know, his sons, like his daughter, it's just really cool to, you know, see how.
But when you're successful and you do like inhuman things, and let's face it, like a 240 mile race doesn't seem natural.
Yeah.
Right. It's just going to always spark a resentment, you know. I killed a bull this year solo with a bow, same thing, public land over the counter hunt. It just bark some resentment.
Yeah,
it just,
always.
It just does.
Anything that we do, there's always going to be somebody that has something negative to say about it, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's just how it is.
But it's really neat. Like, that's a different discussion. I think for overwhelmingly, my experience has been, especially this last year, has been just so much positivity out there. People loving, you know, learning, following the show and all that. It's just an enormous level of positivity. And I think things have swinged a little bit. I think there's a little bit of a tide shift where people are done with some of that social media bitterness and some of that just the judgmental and the wokeness that's out there. People are like, let's just be like nice again.
Well, too, and this is like part of the reason I'm here is because of you, right? So we had this conversation a year and a half ago at the Total Archery Challenge. Like, what do you think of Mountain Ops? Like, why? Like, are you happy there? Are you happy with the company and stuff like that? And you're like, yes, like I come to work every single day and I'm part of such a positive atmosphere and a positive group of people. I mean, everyone in this office, Trevor, Cheryl, they're so wonderful to be around. It's just like this place where you don't have to be scared to, you know, be yourself and everyone's loved and, you know, everyone's given the tools to succeed and be successful. And so for me, like the reason why I came here is because you told me this. You're like, you know, it's such a cool place and it's such a cool environment. And just coming here and being here, I'm just like, wow, this is amazing. Because there's haters on our company. Like, there's haters on Mountain Ops, you know, people they just love to hate us, right? But I don't care. I'm like, you guys don't know one single thing about the lives that we're changing every single day with everything that we do, you know? It's like, and the majority after coming here and seeing, it's like, there's maybe one haters to every 100 lovers, right? Yeah. So it's like, your brand helped change my life, or, you know, Casey and Jordan, following them and seeing what they do has inspired me to change my life. Or you, like a lot of people love everything gritty. And so it's just really cool to be a part of something that's like this. And the more people that we can get to listen to this and hear what an amazing place it is, the more people I think that are like, wow, well, all I do is talk smack on other people and feel bad about myself all the time. Maybe if I decide to like change my circle and be with more positive people, my life will start to change for the best. Mm-hmm. And for me, like, I know that I've never felt so awesome and like had so much positive vibes. Like, I can do anything, like, right?
I've been a Rihana Cary fan forever, right? And I was watching you on Instagram long, like right about when I was just beginning with Gritty, and seeing the things that you're doing. And you're in my neck of the woods. So I saw
Oregonians.
We're both Oregonians and so on. And I'm just soaking it in and watching you and seeing that, of course, you're a gal. And so some guys are discounting every achievement, but I'm looking at it going, nope, the stats and this is real. This isn't fake. And then, you know, you've been on the show many times and shared some of your adventures. And it's like, nope, this is a legit hunter. This isn't someone who's doing it either for love and likes. It's like, this is because you actually like it. No one goes out there for that many days solo and suffers like that unless they really actually want to be there or connecting with nature. There's something deeper. Yeah. And so as I watched that, and you were at a crossroads in your life, where do I go from here? And I was like, you come to Mountain Ops. Like, this is
best
where you be
ever.
Because your talents, your skill set, your personality, your relationships within this industry, it's like this ideal fit. And the one thing that I really wanted you to understand before you came was there is a I've been in two environments. Mm-hmm. I've been in many, but I've been in an environment where everything you do is criticized, where you're constantly being told you're not good enough, where someone's in your head saying you're weak, you can't succeed, or I'm better than you. And then there's an environment here where everybody is like, hey, you got this. Dude, that was incredible.
Yep.
Positive reinforcement, encouragement, giving you tools to succeed.
Yep.
You know, I have this book right here, Jordan Peterson, 12 Rules for Life. Mm-hmm. And one of his rules is surround yourself by people who are genuinely excited for your success.
Yes.
That is much harder than you realize, mm-hmm. because most people are hoping you're going to fail. Not most, a lot of people are hoping you're going to fail, mm-hmm. so they can say, ha, see. And when you surround yourself with people who, you know, like I said earlier, there's a jealousy factor. When you go and do something awesome or cool or fun or amazing, there's people have two choices. They can either celebrate your success mm-hmm. and go, man, that was so cool, congratulations. Or they can go, what a D-bag. That guy totally cheated. Mm-hmm. He didn't do it, blah, blah, blah. He's weak. I could do that too if only, blah, blah, blah. I was given all of this stuff. And you can take those two routes. You can be that negative person that just tears people down, or you can be that person that, and when Jordan Peterson says, hey, surround yourself by people that genuinely celebrate mm-hmm. your success, that's what I did when I came to Mountain yep. Ops. And that's what Mountain Ops does for each other.
Everyone.
And this whole place is just, it's just a joy to be at and yeah. to work at and to be here. And I think people on the outside looking in that maybe don't feel that way about the company.
They don't see that.
You don't see it. It's easy to hate.
It's easy to hate.
It's the easiest route you can take. It's also the easiest route to avoid accountability and extreme ownership.
Yeah.
It's like, no, own your stuff, man.
Yeah.
Own it. If rather than get jealous by someone else's success, anytime you feel a bone of jealousy mm-hmm. coming because someone else did something, it's a red flag that 100%. You've got a problem.
Yep.
Not that person.
Yeah.
You've got a problem. Why aren't you happy for another human being's success?
Yep. And I feel like, too, I'm kind of an easy target. Like, it's easy because look at what the opportunities working with Mountain Ops has given me. I was able to go to Hawaii. I'm able to hunt elk. Like, even within the office, it would be so easy to target me and be like, wow, I don't like what Rihanna's doing. Like, she's always off having fun, you know, or whatnot. Right. Like, that's part of my job is to make people feel good and have fun with them and, you know, relationship build. And so it would be so easy for people to be negative or dislike me, but that's not how it is here, right? And so it's incredible, and it's like I feel so lucky every single day to work here yeah. and around these people. And like Jordan and Casey were actually the first people that I messaged that I got my bowl. I was like, I messaged them from my inReach, and I was like, you guys, I got one. Like, they were the only ones that I wanted to tell. And who else is like that, you know, that they're like my bosses, right? And mm-hmm. so it's like, who else loves their bosses that much? Like, I love Jordan and Casey and Trevor and Joe and everyone that work, yeah. you know, I just love them all. And so it's pretty cool. And I think
it's a pretty neat place in life. I mean, you had to move from Oregon, which is your roots and stuff, and start over. And that was intimidating. I remember we talked about it, and you're like,
oh gosh,
do I want to, can I leave all this behind?
Mm-hmm. Now, 4 years ago, me would never do something like that. But now I'm like, this is an adventure. Like, life is an adventure. You never know what's going to happen. And two, it was kind of like it was more of a calling, right? Which yeah. is, it was very spiritual coming here. Like, everything that happened that led up to coming here, it was like someone telling me, God telling me, like, this is what you need to go and do, right? And so it was just, it's just been really cool, and I feel lucky every single day. And you know, it's just,
when
it's,
I talk to,
I'm like emotional right now.
No, it's good. When I talked to Levi Morgan a few weeks back, because he got back from that Deseret camp too, and he was there. When I talked to Levi, he was explaining how people often quit just before their dream or their mm-hmm. goals are met.
Yeah.
And one of the saddest things I've observed in my life are people who aren't willing to take the chance
Risk.
And aren't willing to let go of, give up, you know, this, their, maybe their connections back home, like you had in Oregon, all mm-hmm. those relationships, give that up to take the risk mm-hmm. of something new. They just wouldn't do it. They just won't. They refuse to move mm-hmm. locations. They refuse to. And the thing is that going out and embarking in the world into mm-hmm. the unknown, going to where, you know, it's all a great mystery and you have no idea how it's going to turn out.
Yeah.
That is where you're, you know, that where you're out there going into that unknown. That's where the growth happens.
Yep.
That's where
you flourish.
That's where the things where you find out who you are or what you can do. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of like a solo hunt. You know, it's like going out there all alone by yourself doing this thing is that's where you start to learn some things mm-hmm. and where you have that potential to reap the greatest rewards, mm-hmm. you know, and too many people just stay safe.
Yep.
They never go out into the unknown.
Yeah. Changing your life is hard to do, but it's worth it, you know, for the best.
Yeah. So
yeah.
What's next for you?
Oh, well, I do have a Montana tag. I got the Montana combo, which I was just there last week, and I was there for 5 days.
Elk rifle.
Elk archery. I was hunting archery because the archery
goes till October
20th.
Oh, it's the 20th? I thought it was the 10th or something. I thought it was over.
No, it goes until October 20th. They extended it this year, and then the 26th is when rifle starts. Mm-hmm. And for me, you know, I went hunting and tried with my bow, and this area that I was hunting, I mean, I've never seen so many elk, but the problem is it's sage flats, like my Idaho bowl. So I was like, I want to try and do this again, because that whole Idaho thing was like crazy that hadn't worked out.
Big herds in those open flats. Oh my gosh, it's different. Tons. Elk in open country behave so different than elk in thick country.
But they're going crazy. They were going nuts. And so I did call one in, actually, and called it straight in to about 40 yards is what I ranged him at. And he just stopped and saw something he didn't like. You know, when you see their eyes and you know, oh, shoot. Okay, well, I better get ready to shoot. And I don't know how far he's going to run out. So I came to full draw and, you know, just guessed and just sailed right over his back. I was like, no.
In those open flats, it's really hard to estimate yardage.
Oh, 100.
There's nothing there to reference.
Nope, nothing. So it was just his body, you know. And so, and I hate doing that. I hate guessing. Honestly, like if I can range, I'd rather range all day. But yeah, I just had already been at full draw, so I guessed. And
I've always asked that question at times. Like, is it ethical to guess, like to estimate yardage, or is it ethical to use a rangefinder? Because you have these two camps. You have people that are like, dude, it's cheating to use a rangefinder. You shouldn't be using one. And then you have people that are, who are like, well, you should never guess.
Well, you're wounding every single animal you shoot at, probably. So
the animal deserves better than a guess. You shouldn't take the shot if you haven't confirmed it.
Well, that Garmin sight.
I know.
I loved that thing in Hawaii. I mean, I wasn't able to use it in Montana or Oregon, obviously. But I tell you what, I freaking love that thing. As soon as you can trust it, like, it was so cool because I shot an axis buck, you know, and so I didn't have to range him at all. I just let my bow do it and I shot him twice. Like, you know, the first shot was a good enough shot, but the follow up, because he was out there, I was able to just come to full draw and range. Like, I didn't have to have my rangefinder as he's walking, you know, so it's just really cool. But yeah, I love that Garmin sight. I
used
it all the time.
Killed that buck in Ohio.
Yeah.
And I really think, you know, that big sexy buck and it really helped. Yeah. I mean, maybe I would have, but the shot was so perfect because I had single yard accuracy and I didn't have to do any extra motion because that thing was wired tight. He knew
something was not
right. And so to be able to just come to full draw, get the bow back when he wasn't looking. Mm-hmm. And then as he moved around, I didn't have to worry about, okay, what yardage is he now? Where is he at? And it was a steep shot, but it calculated all that. In Arizona, the same thing. Coos deer, when you look at a coos deer in the desert and it's standing next to a cactus, I thought the cactus was like 6 feet tall.
Yeah.
It was like 3 feet tall and the coos deer was shorter. It's like they're just tiny little targets. The kill zones are like a cantaloupe maybe.
Yeah,
I mean, you're talking about a really small kill, maybe a softball. And then you have a hard time because when I see a deer, I see a mule deer. Mm-hmm. It's what I've grown up seeing.
Yeah.
Or maybe even a whitetail. And they're 2 to 3 times as large. So when you see that deer out in the desert, you think it's 40 yards away, but it's only 20.
Yeah.
And it messes with your mind, and they're so switched on. It's like they have eyes 360 degrees. And so
I want to go hunt them. That sounds fun.
When you pull your bow back. So last year I was able to get a coos deer with my bow with a perfect shot. And it was a lot. I mean, I don't think I could have done it. It spotted me.
Yeah.
And then it turned its head. And I yanked the bow back, and he switched his head back, and he's like, did something move, you know? But I had to sit there for probably 2 minutes him staring at me. And then he turned his head, and I was like, zoom, back. Yeah. No time to range. I couldn't – if I'd have fumbled for a rangefinder and then tried to range him and then tried to get my bow back.
No time.
He just jerked his head back, and he's like, something moved.
Eyes in the back.
In the meantime, I'm just like, range. Oh, he's 20 yards.
Sweet.
Let the pin drop. I'm like, trust it. Just trust it because I don't know. Pinwheel. And you can't do that. Like, I like that. I think it will increase success levels to a degree, but I also think it would decrease wound rates. And I've said this a lot because the sad truth is, and this happened in Idaho this year, mm-hmm. talked to a lot of guys that shot elk and never found them.
Never found them because they're guessing.
Because they're guessing. They're guessing. Mm-hmm. They're in a hurry. They range. It's at 30 yards. Then it ran, went around a tree, and it's like, I think maybe it's 40. Mm-hmm. And it's a marginal hit, and then it's like you're tracking. And in thick country especially, the faster it dies, the more likely you're going to find it.
Yep.
You know, if you can hit the shot just perfect,
yep.
more likely you're going to find it.
Yep.
And I find like, yeah, you can make shots guessing, mm-hmm. and you can kill animals guessing, but they might live 3 hours
yep.
or 2 hours after the hit. And in that case, they might travel
a lot farther and you're not going to find them.
They may not bleed yeah. if it's a high hit, which is often, you know, what will happen. Mm-hmm. It's a high hit in an elk's rib cage. And it's yep. like that elk is dead, but it just bled internal
yep.
and didn't come out the hole, the wound channel. And so I like the Garmin.
I think
it's sort of like mechanical broadheads, lighted knocks, things like mm-hmm. that. Technology. I understand people are leery of technology. Mm-hmm. It starts to make it too easy. But as I talked to Corey Jacobson this year, he's like, all the tech in the world isn't going to make up for the grit and determination it takes to stay out there, yep. get in position, you know, make those shots. You still have to shoot yep. under pressure. You still have to do all the things. You're just removing that one step of guessing.
Yep. I feel like that needs to be legal in all states.
I do too. But, it's funny. Right now, it's a lot more acceptable, mm-hmm. you know, than it was. I understand the big concern for most people is mm-hmm. they feel like if they use the zero, then it will increase harvest rates, and then no one will get a tag.
But
many animals will be killed.
But yeah, they're dying anyways. That's, you know what I mean? And not being found.
That's kind of my thoughts. I say with technology, mm-hmm. approve new technologies because there's nothing primitive about my compound bow.
Yeah.
It's the state of the art tech.
Yep.
My arrows are state of the art tech. Like everything is state of the art. So the idea that we're using something primitive is just is not real.
Yeah, because how many people with a primitive bow
yeah.
can't get, you know, you're like right. you have to get closer. I mean, it's definitely,
much harder.
And you wound a lot more animals.
So, and that's, that can't, you know, that always sparks a serious debate.
I know.
But in my opinion, you know, as you make technology, mm-hmm. as you make the weapon more and more primitive, the more and more difficult it is to achieve an efficient kill.
Yeah.
And we can argue about that. People argue with that about that all the time. But if you make your own wooden arrow and you put a chiseled tip on the front that you made yourself, I'm just saying that my Valkyrie on my bow is going to be more effective than killing.
100%.
We can argue all we want, but there is a curve where it's like they're inversely related. The more technologically advanced the weapon, the more efficient the weapon is, like a 300 Win Mag, mm-hmm. the more efficient the killing is.
Yeah.
And the more you go toward slinging rocks at it to kill it, the less efficient killing it is, the more, you know, the harder it is to kill it. And that's, you don't get to have, you know, it's this thing where a lot of people that do primitive type hunting, they're like, no, it's just as lethal. No, it isn't. Mm-hmm. It's not just as lethal. And we have the argument all the time. I think it's kind of a silly argument because you want it to be the most challenging and most difficult achievement to do it with the primitive weapon. Mm-hmm. But then you also want to own that it's just as lethal and efficient.
Yeah.
It's like, how can it be the most challenging and the most difficult means of hunting, but also be the most lethal?
I don't see that.
They're inversely related.
Now, I've never done it, so I can't say, but for me, it just doesn't make sense. And you know what? There's nothing that's going to take away the accomplished feeling I get from using a compound on, you know, shooting an animal. So it's like, that still gives me
you shot the bull at 10 yards.
Yeah.
That's recurve range.
I could have used recurve.
That's what people do. You know,
a lot of people,
the argument often is get closer.
Yeah.
And the compound allows you to shoot farther.
Yeah.
But, you know, I said this to a friend of mine who couldn't pull a recurve anymore because their shoulder. I was like, well, what do you love about the recurve? And a big part of it was just, it makes me get close.
Yeah.
Like, well, just have some discipline.
Yeah.
Only shoot with a compound that you can pull at 50 pounds, you know, because it doesn't hurt your shoulder. Just
getting close.
And just get close. Yeah. Get to your 20 or 15 yard mark.
I think all the bulls that I've shot, well, except for the one in Idaho, well, that was 60, but I think all the other ones have been 20 and less.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, calling them in, you know, or what,
yeah.
Stalking. So.
But I do like I do worry about technology becoming so advanced, like mm-hmm. crossbows, that they reduce the number of people who can get a tag because too many are being killed. So we got to reduce tag.
It's all about a balance. Crossbows, so, I would say no.
But that's why I say that's where technology goes too far, yeah. In a season or in a mm-hmm. weapon category is when it starts to change the actual number of animals available for harvest.
Yeah.
The whole point of having an archery season is to give people, well, there's a lot of points to it, but one of the main points to having an archery season is to allow the greatest number of people to go hunt.
Yep.
Because the success rates are 10%,
yep.
Or 7 or 5. So now we can give away 100 tags because when we only want 5 elk killed.
Yep.
If you did rifle, it's like, well, we can give out 5 tags
because it's like 100%. They're all going to get one.
Right.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
so yeah, yeah. I get that. And so we don't want our mm-hmm. archery seasons to be all of a sudden like a rifle season because technology has made it so amazing that it can be done. So when tech starts to move over into that space, I'm like, yeah, we need to pull back what we call archery hunting.
But also,
But I don't think the zero actually, like people are afraid it does. I don't think that zero actually is as impactful as people think it is. I think it just reduces the amount of animals that get wounded.
I still can't shoot past 80 yards with it. You know, right. I mean, it still is the same sight. It's just one pin. It makes you more accurate and you can have a follow-up shot a lot easier with it. Yeah. You know, you don't have to range them. So yeah. I'm a huge proponent of it. And two, like I tell people, try it. Just see what you think about it. If you don't like it or you feel like it changes your success or whatever, like, I don't know. For me, well, I don't feel like it does. But it
I said this a while ago. I was like, well, finally we have a sight that matches the state-of-the-art technology of our bow. Because if you look at the bow mm-hmm. and how it's built and what they do to make a bow and the arrows and all of and the broadheads and the fletchings and the lighted knot, and you look at the whole system, you're like, ooh, this is like a sparkly, shiny, like Tesla, mm-hmm. right? Like
yeah, Tesla.
So state-of-the-art.
Yeah.
And then what do? We put this crappy little like Allen key mechanical sight on there that you got to like like move the pins individually, yeah. Print off a sight tape on a computer, do if you have a slider and all these things. It's like, really? That's mm-hmm. I got to do this? Or now I take with that whole, I have a sight that actually coincides with the bow, slap that sucker on and it's like, I can be sighted in like 15 minutes.
Way faster.
From 0 to 80, 90 yards.
And different arrow profiles. That's
different
my favorite.
Arrows, different arrows, mm-hmm. different releases.
Yeah.
It's like the sight is now caught up with the bow.
Yeah, I agree.
And now we don't have to carry this rangefinder in your pocket.
I still carry mine, just in case.
I do too. But you don't have to like, it's so funny because when rangefinders came out, people were like, you need to make these illegal.
Because, oh my gosh.
Because it's going to increase harvest rates. Too many people are going to kill. But it's the same concept. Did rangefinders make people more successful or did it reduce the amount of animals that got killed overall?
Or, yeah.
You know, because now you're making effective shots.
Yep.
It's the same argument with the zero.
Yeah.
It's the same argument. Does the zero do the same thing as handheld rangefinders do? Yeah, I believe it probably reduced the amount of animals hurt, not increase. But there are people who say now because you have a rangefinder, you can make an 85-yard shot. So guys are out there taking shots that they shouldn't be taking because they have a rangefinder.
Yeah.
And that is true. But I don't think you design you don't design rules around what people might do that are irresponsible. It's like,
If somebody's going to be irresponsible, they're going to do it.
If that were true, there'd be no Second Amendment, right? Like no guns. We don't get to have guns because mm-hmm. someone might shoot somebody with one. We don't have cars because someone might drive
super
fast and break the law because they like speed. It's like we don't design rules around what people might do to break them.
Yeah.
You design rules around what reasonable. Good people are going to do.
Yeah.
And so it doesn't make sense to me to say, all of us would love to make a great shot, would like to make a really ethical and efficient shot. Mm-hmm. And the zero allows me to just take out a step, but also rarely ever have to guess.
Yeah.
In that moment of truth, I can just take one or two seconds and get single pin accuracy. Mm-hmm. And the shorter your draw length, the lighter poundage you can pull, like in the case of a lot of women, mm-hmm. or small cousins like Ben, it's like that allows the, you know, I have a much greater advantage than you. Mm-hmm. I'm shooting 285, 90 feet per second.
Mine's not too bad. It's 260, I think.
That's not bad, but my arrow weighs way more than yours.
Oh, yeah. That's true. That's way more. Lot.
And so that kinetic energy and that poundage is just going to punch through.
Yeah.
Where yours got the speed, but it doesn't have the power.
How heavy is your arrow?
The arrow I'm shooting right now is 465 grains.
Oh, my gosh. Wow. Yeah, mine's 365.
That's a big difference. And my other arrow from last year was 515 grains.
Wow. But I've used those before. I used grizzly sticks for a long time, and I felt like it took forever to shoot the dang animal.
Totally.
And I wasn't any more accurate. So it's like, I'm not doing this any longer. I'm going to get a bow that has
a little more speed.
Yeah.
But here's
it's a balance.
Here's the thing.
Yeah.
By having the zero, someone like you with the setup you've got going a little slower, if let's say you wanted to increase the weight of your arrow a little bit to give it a little more punch, it's going to slow your bow way down.
Yep.
And so having a sight, because at 30 yards, out to 40 yards, I can use the same pin.
Yeah.
The same pin.
Not I.
You can't do that.
I mean, if I were to get up to 65, 70 pounds, but 60 is good for me. And I do have a shorter draw length. Jeff's draw length is 31 and a half or something.
Exactly. I felt like Dudley. I'm like, that's not fair. Don't even tell me how to do it. Like, I have a 27 inch draw. Like, there's such a difference in the equipment he's allowed to use and the setup and the design than me.
Yeah.
And same for you. Yeah. That's why I think the zero can be very, very helpful to like my wife and my daughter.
Yeah.
Because when they're guessing between 30 and 40, they need to know to the
yard. Yeah. I'm the same way. My sight that actually is adjustable. It has every yard. I mean, it has, you know, 36, 37, 38,
I don't have to worry about that. And guys like Jeff, they definitely don't have to worry about
that. No, I know. I'm excited for him to start shooting.
So that's where I feel like, you know, let's, yeah. Anyway, that's a tangent.
No.
That was great.
No, it was good. It was good. Yeah, no, that was a good talk. I need to hear more about your bowl.
Yeah, I talked about a little bit on I kind of did the solo story, but it was really cool. I enjoyed the, I've got a few people saying, I thought this was a solo hunt on YouTube. And they're like, what about this is solo? Solo is when you're alone. And maybe they didn't listen to the whole episode or they commented too early or whatever. But I hunted 6 days, the opening days of archery with my cousin Ben.
Mm-hmm.
Then I hunted 3 days solo. Mm-hmm. And then Ben brought his son up for the weekend, Saturday, Sunday. And then they left. And then I hunted like 5 days solo, killed my bull solo, packed it out solo. It was all solo.
Yeah.
So, it's really not that complicated. I shot it solo. I hunted solo. I shot it solo and I packed it out solo.
People
it's pretty solo. I don't know how else you label it. Like, what else do you call it?
Everyone's going to have their own two cents or opinions on things, but you know how it made you feel. And that's what matters. It made you feel like, you know, on top of the world, I'm sure.
Yeah, and I don't want to claim any kind of thing I've done that I didn't do. Mm-hmm. So I'm always trying to present the most accurate, you know,
depiction of
what happens. Yeah. But it was really cool. I look forward to a lot more solo stuff.
I love it. I love just hunting by myself, honestly. I love hunting with other people too, honestly. I like it both, but
I have lost patience with a lot of hunting with other people because most people don't want to do it the way I do.
Yeah, that's true.
Most people, I lose patience because I'm like, when they start to be weak, Rihana, I lose patience. When they don't want to climb the hill because it's too far or they don't want to pack the animal all night because it's too hard, mm-hmm. or I just am like, I should just be by myself.
Yep.
And Lampert's is like that too.
So you guys are a good match.
We're a good match because
yeah.
Neither one of us are going to quit.
Yeah.
We did some stupid things in New Zealand.
Oh, I bet.
And we did some stupid things on some packouts. Neither one of us were going to be the one that quit, though.
Quit, yeah.
We're going to both die first.
That's going to be bad. That's a bad relationship there.
It could be. We talked about that, in fact. Like, maybe we need some sort of...
like, somebody there.
Check or balance, you know?
Yeah. Oh, that's funny.
We were careful, yeah. I guess, to an extent. But I'm going with Ryan next week.
Yeah.
Yep. We're going to do a backcountry kind of super cool adventure.
And that'll be rifle.
Rifle, mule deer. And it's going to be sick.
That'll be fun. I'm jealous. I wish my tags were in Idaho. I'd go with you guys.
It's miles and miles.
Oh, wow. And you guys are walking in the whole way?
Yeah. And we've got a raft. So we're going to do some rafting with the alpaca pack raft. We got to cross a couple of rivers. Ryan's trying to take us where he thinks no one can get to or has been in like 15 years.
Oh my gosh.
And or longer. So, and then we got good weather pushing the mule deer off the mountaintops, and yeah, so it's
I'm excited for you. I can't wait to hear about it.
It'll be really
pictures.
Cool. It's funny cuz I've bow hunted a lot in my life, mm-hmm. and I also rifle hunted a lot.
Yeah.
And I've done quite a bit of both, and I got to say, like, I seek adventure.
Mm-hmm.
Really. I want the challenge and the adventure,
yeah.
and I want to experience a little bit of danger, a little bit of, but yeah. within reason.
Yeah.
And I want to see things that people don't see
because
yep. they don't put themselves in places that
like
are
that.
Like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, rifle, the weapon doesn't matter that much to
mm-hmm.
me. And when I rifle hunt, it's like the, like in the tar and the New Zealand thing we did the Southern Alps kind of rugged mountaineering kind mm-hmm. of hunting. And then we did the grasslands rolling hills.
Yeah.
And the grasslands rolling hills was kind of anticlimactic with a rifle in hand.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, we really wished we had a bow with us
yeah.
for that particular stage. Cause it wasn't that much adventure
mm-hmm.
with a rifle.
Yeah.
Whereas
the
other one was plenty of adventure.
Yeah, it's like
rifle.
Almost too much. You're like, am I going to fall off this cliff?
Yeah, and I found yeah. like whitetail hunting. Mm-hmm. If I'm going to go out and sit in a tree stand and I'm going to be somewhere and it's just, I kind of want the bow to make it that challenge.
Oh, yeah.
If I had a rifle, I'd probably tag out right away.
Yeah.
And it would feel not rewarding enough.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've found like I'm using the weapon to sort of, it's overall it's adventure and bringing meat home and all
yeah.
that always, of course, but it's adventure. And I'm just sort of like weaving the weapon in to make it to either add or reduce the adventure that's
adventure.
Already
yeah.
out there.
Yeah.
You know, it's crazy.
You guys will have so much fun and you're filming it too.
Yeah. And then I've got a over the counter elk hunt.
Oh.
That's backcountry rifle as well. Just
in
an
Idaho?
Over-the-counter public land. I'm going to do Colorado.
Oh, nice.
It'll be the third year in a row I've done Colorado.
Did you have success the past few years?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, nice.
Yep. So.
Yeah. Hopefully my Montana tags will be fun. I have that deer and the elk, so I'm excited. I'm glad my elk hunting isn't over, but
yeah.
I'm going to use a boomstick. I'm like, I don't, you know.
It's fun.
Yeah.
I like it. I like, there's certain fun that comes from rifle hunting. It's a
I honestly
kind of trip.
I feel like I'm a better shot with a bow than I am a rifle, to be completely honest with you.
Suzanne feels the same way.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I, you know, I've spent enough time now the last couple of years behind mm-hmm. a gun that I feel really good behind a gun.
Yeah.
But I remember when I first started really, I was much more comfortable shooting a bow than gun.
Gun, yeah.
Early on, because I just grew up doing it since I was a little kid. My dad had a bow in my hand mm-hmm. and my dad archery hunted every year. And,
yeah.
We never really killed much. Every now and then he'd get a few does, you know, here and there. And, but archery and, rifle, I love it all.
Mm-hmm.
And this way you can extend your season, you know,
oh,
now
yeah.
you get to go 100%. Back out into the woods and you hunt different when you have a rifle too.
Yeah.
Like, what I'm willing to shoot with a rifle is utterly different, than when I'm willing to shoot with a bow.
For sure.
You know, when we were in Idaho on that youth hunt, it's a rifle hunt.
Yeah.
And it's like, we would, Anthony turned to me, he's like, dude, we would take any bull.
Yeah.
Any bull. Yeah. Pretty much, you know, especially in this basin right here, because we saw like 25 bulls.
Yeah.
Take any of these. But with a rifle in hand and a week left to hunt, no.
Yeah.
And day after day, you pass on things because the rifle would make it too easy.
Yeah.
The challenge is actually trying to find that rare critter.
Yeah.
You know, and it has its own challenge to it. And I think that's why Lampers likes mule deer hunting with a rifle, late season. Mm-hmm. It's because
you can be more picky.
Yeah. With the bow, you're like, that 150 will do.
Yeah.
You know, that's a nice deer.
Yeah, because they'll be rutting when you guys are just starting, you think?
It'll be pre-rut.
Pre-rut. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when you guys go.
At least the last part, the last few days of our hunt should be pretty hot that way.
Yeah.
Who knows? I mean, we could smash some giants or we could come out nothing. You don't know until you get back there.
I know. That's crazy.
But there's wolves and bears and cougars. And
are there grizzlies?
No. Well.
There could be.
Yeah.
Ugh, I know. That was my fear of hunting Montana, but I was like, I've got a grizzly bear with Montana, me, so, basically.
And, yeah, Montana and Wyoming are the places to worry about, I think. Idaho's got some areas, but...
Well, the area that I was hunting, there was some grizzly attacks right, like, nearby, so...
Really?
Yeah. But they're open sage flats, too, so it's like, if I saw one, it would be from a long ways away. I'd be able to get away. It's not like coming around a bush and seeing one there, you know. So
I don't know. The grizzly thing is definitely a concern, especially given that.
Well, we're from Oregon. We didn't have to deal with that there.
Well,
you know?
And they just don't get hunted.
Yeah.
And so they have. They have. They are never pressured in any way.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, they're bold. You know. Yeah. Period. There's. What are you going to do? They start to figure out that if they just walk into your camp and do stuff, that you're not going to do anything.
They're going to go after my tent because I'm always the one that has snacks in my tent.
I listened to that comedian like, why do people go camping? I mean, seriously, you're climbing into like a burrito sack. It's like if it comes in to try to eat you, it's like, oh, a human in a burrito. Yeah. He's like, what are you going to do? Fight your way out of it? You're in a sleeping bag. You're going to karate chop him? You know, it's like.
Oh, gosh.
But it's true.
Freaky.
You're like going out into the wilderness and you're climbing into a straitjacket and then you're lying there for the eating.
Thanks, but no thanks. I'm good.
Yeah. Anyway.
Yay. Well,
thanks for coming on the podcast.
Yeah, no, it was good to catch up with you because I haven't seen you in a million years. During hunting season,
now
right?
I told my wife hasn't seen me much either, and it's like September, October, November, and we are
halfway through.
Gone, but during those 3 months, you know, guys, people, we're out hunting, we're out doing. There's only so many falls per year, and especially us Western elk hunters, it's September's sacred
month. I'm so sad it's over, to be completely honest. I was just thinking about that last night. I was like, why is September over? Now we have to wait a whole nother year for it. But, you know.
It's all right.
I know. We'll have hunts in between.
Yeah.
Now I want to do a New Zealand bow.
Me too. That's the goal. I'm going to try to fit that in this year.
Yeah.
The way that New Zealand is price point wise.
In
the way that Lampers and I did it through our tar series, it's really, it's possible, especially given this is my job, that I could do that hunt for $2,500 round trip.
Yeah.
Archery.
Don't be telling everyone this.
It's too late.
Just kidding. No, you can't go.
It's too late. I already have a million people who hate me. Oh, it's funny. Like Corey Jacobson too. Like He's well hated by a lot of elk hunters.
Elk hunters.
He tells people how to hunt.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. I'm torn because
if you want to do it,
the goal is to help people have adventures,
true.
I think.
That's true.
And so if we hoard the information, it's like, it's just not, it doesn't, in the long run, it doesn't help humanity, I don't think. Helps
That's
you.
A good point,
helps an individual.
Brian. That's a good point.
Change your attitude.
Seriously, okay. I've been woke.
All right. Thanks,
awesome.
Rihana.
Yeah, good talking with you.
All right. Stay greedy.